Who are we, Lord? Who are we? Who am I? That you would want to know me, that you would want to hear my prayer. And yet, I am your child, and that's exactly what you want to do. You desire a relationship with us. Who am I and all my mess-ups and my troubles and my pains and sorrows? And you want to know it all. You want to know us. You want to know us intimately, and you want us to know you intimately. So as we come here right now, Lord, to worship you, we say, who am I? We say, we are your children. We are the sheep of your pasture. We are here to worship you and praise you and to remember that you are always with us. Your love never fails. It never gives up on us. And so hear our prayer, Lord, today, and open our hearts to your word and to our worship. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. So one day, Buck Barba and Kenny Zagari and Bob Lewis, they were hiking in Bear Mountain, of all places, if you can imagine that. They were hiking in Bear Mountain, and they came upon a very large, raging river, and they needed to get to the other side. But they didn't have any idea how to do this. You know, Kenny's not much of an outdoorsman, but he prayed. He did it. He prayed, and he said, please, God, give me the strength to cross the river. Oh, poof. God answered his prayer. Kenny developed these muscles in his shoulders and his arms, his legs, and he swam right across this raging river. Well, then Buck prays, and, you know, Buck Barba, you know, with all his jokes and everything, but he wasn't joking with God. He just seeing that, you know, that it worked for Kenny miraculously. He was praying for a miraculous prayer, for a miraculous answer to his prayer. So he prays, please, Lord, give me the strength and the tools to cross the river. Well, all of a sudden, God gave Buck a rowboat, and he was able to row across the river. Of course, he capsized a couple of times, but he got back in the boat and he got to the other side of the river. Now Bob, he sees that these two guys have prayed and there's miracles going on. So he sees how God has answered his prayers and that prayers work. And so he prays as well. And Bob says, dear God, please give me the strength, the tools, the intelligence to cross the river. And God answers his prayer. He turns him into a woman. And she looks at a map. She realizes she just has to hike down a few hundred yards and walk across the bridge. Oh my gosh. What can I say? You know, these are the guys that, you know, Noelle says back in the pew, she says, what a crew you have. And yeah, well, this is part of the crew. Anyway, I could go on and on. Mary Beth, I was listening to her prayers this morning. I just happened to walk by her room and hear her praying, and she's praying, and I heard her say, you know, Lord, so far I'm doing okay. I haven't gossiped. I haven't lost my temper. I haven't been greedy. I haven't been grumpy. I haven't been nasty. I haven't picked on pastor. I haven't been selfish. And I'm really glad about all that. And then I hear, but God, in a few minutes, I'm going to get out of bed. And I'm really going to need your help. Amen. Oh, and by the way, did you know that they have, there's now a hotline for 1-800 dial a prayer for atheists. You call, and it rings and rings and rings. Okay. We all know and we all believe in prayer, right? We know that prayer is talking with God. We know that prayer is listening to God. And that seems very simple, doesn't it? And prayer really is very simple. But the simplicity of the prayer, praying, kind of gets us not thinking about the depth of what prayer is about and how important it is, how significant prayer is to our life, and how and why God delights in our prayers, and also the prayer, that prayer is a privilege, you know, and so God wants a relationship with us. That's what we need to establish. God wants a relationship with us. He wants to be our best friend. He wants us to to enjoy him, you know? And it's difficult to understand this, that God would want me. We just sang it. You know, who am I? Who are you? Each one of us, who are we that God, this awesome, powerful, all glorious God would want to know me? I'm pretty messy and pretty, pretty much turn my back on him and get busy with life and forget about God, or I'm not very pleasant to other people, whatever it is, the burdens that you're carrying. Some people are carrying drug burdens and alcohol burdens, or whatever it is that you're carrying. You feel like you're not a nice person, whatever it is. It's difficult to understand that God would want a relationship with us. You know, we're sinners, we're messed up, and we're louses, you know, for some of us, or all of us, because we're sinners. But God wants a friendship with us. It says, who am I that the Lord of all the earth, of heaven and earth, would care to know my name? You stop and you think about that. Well, the Bible says in Exodus chapter 34, he is a God who is passionate about his relationship with you. Yeah. Isn't that something? That God really wants a relationship with us. So God wants to be at home in our hearts. He doesn't want to be a sometimes God, or the foxhole God. You know, when we're in a real jam, then we call out to him. And he wants to be what we call the North Star. That's how people navigated, back a couple of thousand years ago, the North Star. He wants to be our North Star. He wants to be the one that we navigate life by and through. He wants us to know that he loves us and he cares for us. And this is a great privilege we have as Christians. And this privilege, though, has a maintenance schedule, if you will. You know, we have the privilege of having this relationship with God. And so to maintain this relationship, we need to nurture this relationship, just as we nurture our relationships with family and friends and in our marriages, so that we can, can have a pleasant or a home life that's good and wholesome. You know, we nurture our relationships. Well, God wants us to nurture a relationship with him. And as we nurture relationships, what do? We talk to one another, we share our feelings, we dine together. Here we dine at the table. We sing together, we play together, we bowl together, whatever it is. We go golfing together, and we're nurturing a relationship and talking to one another and enjoying one another. Well, that's the human relationship. How much more important and deep is the relationship we have with God? And so he wants us to communicate with him with this living, active, loving, and forgiving God. And so God delights in prayer, and he wants us to pray relentlessly, continually, and without ceasing, says scripture. And so it's an intimate communication. It's not just saying, hey God, give me a nice day today, don't give me any problems today. It goes deeper than that. He wants to know why you don't want the problems. He wants to know where you might feel that you have problems. And so it's deeper than just saying, oh, Lord, give me a good day. Amen. You know, it's a communication process that allows us to talk to God. And there is nothing you cannot say to our Heavenly Father. You know, we have our skeletons in the closet, things we don't want anybody to know about us. But we can go to our Heavenly Father. We can talk to our Heavenly Father. And we can either speak it aloud, or we can speak it in our mind and our heart. There's nothing that you, me, we need to hold back from God. And why is that? Because God knows everything already. God does not want us to be burdened by our pain and our sin and the skeletons in our closet. He doesn't want us to be burdened by that. He wants us in the way he knows, God knows, that we unburden it, is by confessing it, giving it over to God. So prayer is about a deeper communication than, hey God, keep me safe. God does not want us to drown in our problems He does not want to drown us to drown in our pain and our predicaments. So consider this. Nothing ever takes God by surprise. Think about that. Nothing ever takes God by surprise. He's aware of every aspect, every thought, every feeling, every pain, every problem, every joy, every celebration. He's already aware of that. So why not speak to him? Why not tell God? Why not confess? Why not speak to God in a deeper, more intimate way? From Hebrews chapter 4. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God. Everything is naked and exposed before his eyes, and we are accountable to him and him alone. Nothing in all creation is hidden from God, you see, so why not talk to him? So yet, he still loves us. He still loves us and desires to love us with an everlasting love. We are here to receive it. We are here to let it grow in our hearts. And when we do, that's when prayer is fully alive and fully powerful and fully serious and earnest. It has a strength and a power that, because we are going deeper and God is healing our heart and healing our sin-sick soul when we speak to him from the depth of who we are, and who we are is mess-ups. So we need to acknowledge who God is and see him as the Lord, the supreme God, the ruler of heaven and earth, the Lord of all things, including our very lives. He is God and we are not. He is God and we are not. It's understanding that, and that he has the power and the strength, the desire to listen and care and hear us. And with God being God and we are not God, prayer keeps this relationship in perspective, because we are on our knees. We are humbled before God. Prayer keeps us in a relationship of God as Father, the Heavenly Father, the glory, the one who helps us and cares for us and moves us through the issues and the problems of our lives. We are not the ones who do that, and then when we give up and throw up our hands, we go to God and say, okay, now it's your turn, God. I forgot to tell you about Buck. So Buck, he's got a friend, and his friend says to him, because Buck loves donuts, he says, why did you get donuts today? I thought you were watching your weight and you're going on a diet. And Buck said, I was, but I prayed. And I prayed, and I asked God to, if there was a parking space in the front of the donut shop, then that was a sign that I should stop and get donuts. And so I drove around 8 times and there finally was a spot and I got my donuts. That's what I'm saying. We pray and we think we're answering our own prayers. Say, no, don't worry about it, God. I got it taken care of. I got a parking space. You see? And so the relationship, we keep it in perspective and realize that we are humbled before God. And so prayer allows us to worship and praise him. And that's what we do. Even when we're sitting here, we're worshiping and praising him through our songs, through our prayers, through our greeting of one another. We are worshiping God as we come to the altar as well. We are worshiping God. We are praying to God. We are speaking to God in our praise. And so it allows us to confess. Prayer also allows us to express our thanks, and it allows us the opportunity for us to present our requests to God. It allows us to care for others. Don't forget, when we pray for other people, prayer allows us to care for others, and our hearts change. And I know, and we were talking about that in the office this morning when Kenny told us a story about pumping gas, that we have eyes to see God more when we are praying more. whether we get the answer we want, God is answering prayers in mighty ways, and we sometimes can't see it, and it's a journey. Sometimes we see it immediately. But when we pray more, we see God more. We all of a sudden see him working in many ways, and we call them God moments here at Holy Cross. And so prayer is not a monologue. We need to remember that. It's a dialogue. And one of the hardest things for us to do as human beings is to stop and listen for God's voice. Listen for his response to our prayer. And so sometimes, many times, does God hear our prayers? Is he listening? Is he tired of hearing our prayers? Is he tired of hearing my name? And he never tires. And so God is listening to you. The question is, are you listening to him? Are we listening to him? Part of prayer is to remain quiet and listen to God. God does answer prayers. It's in his time. And perhaps the answer is no. And perhaps the answer comes way down the road. Perhaps the answer comes in little moments where we see God active in our lives. But God does answer every single prayer, but we need to listen. Your prayers are always heard by God. There is no prayer too small, there is no prayer too big, and there is no prayer too difficult for God to listen to and respond to. And I want to repeat, there's no prayer that is too small. Sometimes I have you all say to me, well, I don't want to pray for that because there's bigger, people have bigger problems than my little problem. Well, if you don't want to offer it up in church, certainly offer it up to to God, and just let him hear you. You'll be amazed at what you see in God's action in the world. And when you do this, you'll grow more deeply in love with the God who loves you. And you'll see more of your God in your lives. So the question I have for you is, how is your prayer life? In the next couple of weeks, we're going to be talking about God calling us to pray continually. And then we're going to talk about some styles of prayer and when you can do it and how you can do it. But it's a powerful privilege and gift that God gives us. My computer didn't work this morning, so I don't have a video, but Doris already gave a sermon video, and so we're going to move on to prayer. Heavenly Father, we're talking about prayer here, and we realize how important and what a privilege it is. And even in here at Holy Cross, Lord, one of the things that everybody says, even though it takes time in the morning to gather those prayers on a Sunday morning, they are so vitally important to building our community of faith, to building a family so that we can reach out to one another. We know their troubles, one another's troubles and pains, at least some of them, and we can minister to one another. Prayer is such a privilege and a gift, and we can lay hands on loved ones. And sometimes we do that here, Lord, and you bless those prayers. And so we're claiming this gift, Lord. We're claiming this privilege. We want to go deeper in our prayer life and grow stronger in our faith, therefore. Grow stronger in our relationship with you means that we can share who you are with others. Who am I? Well, we answer that question, Lord. Who am I? We are sinners in need of your salvation, your love, your forgiveness, your grace poured out upon us, and you do just that. So as your people, as your children, sheep of your pasture, we rejoice in this privilege to call upon you. And so we ask, Lord, that each and every Sunday as we bring our prayers forth, that we would have patience with one another when it takes a long time, and that we would also remember that as we're gathering in prayers, that we could pray for those people and those problems right then and there. Help us to use the great tool of prayer text time to just reach out to someone, whether it be here in the pews or at home and watching TV or whatever. you know, just remembering someone, and when their name or their face comes across our mind, that we could just whisper a prayer to you. Because those moments that someone comes across our mind are you, Lord, reminding us that we have people around us who need prayer. And so right now, Lord, we pray for those people that we've gathered, their names and their situations that we've gathered today. We may not know them, and that's okay, because you do know them. And we pray for their struggles. And so first of all, we pray for Kim Collio and Richie Ferenti,